Turning to other rich people news. New cannabis licensees in Illinois face David versus Goliath fight against industry giants, according to the Chicago Tribune.
As Illinois begins to award much-delayed cannabis business licenses, the new business owners will face a long uphill climb. They'll be pitting mom-and-pop startups against giant companies that have had a five-year head start to take control of the market.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But how well have they been doing, though? I mean, you're a consumer. You're the person. You live out there. GTI's got a shitty name already. What about these other
I'd say that the market demographics of Illinois cannabis is at least two-thirds black or gray market. So like illicit or gray. And so just using the shades for that purpose alone,
right.
At least. And so like I just grow home grow. I mean, I just use home grow. And then I will buy weed sometimes as a novelty, basically, you know, just to see how they're doing. And to be like, wow, that was expensive. Yeah.
But how's the quality though? I mean, it's expensive, but is it also decent?
No. This artisan Dutch berry that fell from just like a hole in the space time continuum opened from Seattle and it just appeared in Illinois. That is way better. And it was $37 out the gate, guys. $37 total after all the taxes baked into that cake out the door. And it's better. Like the smell profile's better. It's not lying. I think it's not lying to me about its THC content. It only says 23%. It wonderful flavor, decent effects.
So that is, wow. Yeah. You guys definitely need a long catching up. So entry level entrepreneurs will have in many cases, one dispensary to compete with companies that control up to 10 stores across the state. Now, are they vertical owned? Is that how that works?
Many of the operators that are currently in Illinois are vertically owned and they're maxed out. And so like a Cresco is maxed out in Illinois with 10 dispensaries and several of the cultivation licenses. I think Cresco has like 221,000 times two. So like 442,000 square foot of flowering canopy that it could make, which is thousands and tens of thousands of pounds. And so as Cresco's just sitting there spinning oil, cause like they can't sell all their flour. Wow. And so like that's one of the reasons why when I have my, growers that won, I'm saying maybe we should look at what Sitka had and like the Seattle Bubble Works are doing. What are these smaller producers doing? Well, they're offering something different. And, the hash joint, those 9-pound hammer hash joints, fantastic. So you could buy one of those in Washington State for $13. It's a whole gram. And again, maybe if we don't show the prices and we just talk about the industry like this, we're going to wake up tomorrow and this one will be flagged and we'll be like, well, at least 2,000 people got to see it before it was buried. but the hash joints that we got over there were an amazing price point, higher quality than what you have here. And so if you had such a product to offer, and then not only that, everybody who won is social equity. So we need to get like a social equity made stamp. And then there's the locality because there's a lot of public private partnerships between the community that where these suckers were awarded and the brands that'll come thereafter. I mean, wouldn't it be great if your craft grow 2,000 to depending on how many canopy space you have, let's say 5,000-6,000 pounds on the high end after you've been fully canopied. Maybe you can sell all 6,000 pounds in 100 miles, you know?
Yeah. Well, that's the thing, right? I think you guys might be coming up, provided you can have good first grows and everything. You might be coming up to the age of the craft grow where the consumer will be like, all right, I'd rather spend whatever your average price is on the small guy versus the big creepy guy, you know? Right. So hope the consumer's going to have to decide, again, the market no matter what at the end, right?
Right. But, you know, Roger will get in a lab with some of the winners and they'll create some great strains and we'll market them. And it's kind of how it works.
Yeah, it'll be fun, dude. Yeah. I'm excited for your adventure in the cannabis space out there.
Well, it's going to be really interesting as the Eastern Seaboard lights up. Something that's kind of slipping out of New Jersey future news. In New Jersey future news, It looks like they may be blowing a deadline in 3 weeks. And so we might get an idea and a glimpse of some rules on the 21st of August, but we also may get some winners in New Jersey medical cannabis licenses in August, and then election in November. But it's slowly moving forward. You have to really see what the state wants.
And you know, a little word of advice to all these starter uppers in all the states that are just starting, even Oklahoma, especially Oklahoma, because you're going to have people making a lot of money and they're doing shortcuts, whether it be the codes, building codes or location, but save that money and reinvest in your company to build to a higher standard, because eventually one federal legalization comes, or your state does recreational legalization, the codes are going to come down hard and they're going to come down every way. And because there is already a way for the most part to do things, you know, but the other part, like the legislation, that's going to be the gray area.
Yeah. Legislation and rulemaking, they take time. So tomorrow the Cannabis Administration and Opportunity Act passes and everybody goes like, well, we did it. We legalized weed. And then there's a big cloud of smoke and then regulations start to happen. And that's when like NJ Weedman's going to make another $5 million. Cause it's be like, you realize we got 5 years before anybody knows what they're doing. Right.
Yep. Seriously.
Yep.
And that's it. You just got to be able to take that stance. And I'm, well, I never did because I've already been focused on my main goal, which was, it's been the metrology position of I work. You know, my skill set is, I know my skill set, and it's not going to be growing to pay the bills come tomorrow. You know, I have to learn to grow. Just because I smoke a lot of weed doesn't mean I grow.
You know it. Just because you smoke it doesn't mean you grow it.
Yeah, man.
But the Illinois thing is going to be real fun. And so hopefully these Illinois operators can go out there and raise some money with some Main Street businesses, middle market businesses. It's a business and family ownership of that business between $2 and $50 million. Those people can finally get into the game because now they've pointed at the social equity, all veterans so far that have been awarded licenses, and they know who they need to bring into the team.
Yeah. So with this, are there any pushbacks from the Goliaths? Is there any lawsuits pending?
No. The lawsuits are all from the startups, and they don't really like the operators that are there. They don't really need the lawsuits. They have complete and absolute hegemony. 77% of legal weed in March in Illinois was produced by just six companies: Verano, Cresco, Green Thumb Industries, Ascend Holding, PharmaCann, and Revolution.
Damn.
Yep.
Well, even looking at so the State Department of Agriculture awarded the permits, but it has kept secret who the winners are and what their scores are. Where officials said only that 2/3 of the owners are Black or Latino. All the majority veteran-owned. One answer question is whether the winners are in-state investors or out-of-state MSOs. That's interesting, man.
Oh, there's a hodgepodge, I'm sure. But it looked like the vast majority of them were the 51% ownership social equity veterans that tended to be minorities. And so, Illinois said they were going to bring social equity, and I think they can say that they delivered it. And those were the top scoring applicants.
You guys dumped a lot of money. Craft applicants already have invested about $100 million and 1 million hours into the industry, according to a survey by the association. They plan to invest another $500 million in the next 8 months so they can build and get underway. Jeez Louise.
Jeez Louise it is. And it's just kind of what happens, man. It's just kind of what happens when the industry is on. And I don't necessarily disagree with it. And like, you know, one of these days I should get around to doing an expository paragraph about why a limited market over time may be a fairly decent way to introduce cannabis legalization into your state. And one of the reasons why maybe we are 3-4 years away from federal legalization, because the infrastructure hasn't been built up in states, even like New York, New Jersey, as their medical programs weren't all that great. They weren't as big as like Florida's. Florida's medical program is huge, for example.
Well, especially New York, because, you know, New York's the gateway to like most of the, you know, international, you know, their international airport, as right. far as like international travelers go, God, and tourism or whatever. So New York is the first impression that most of these people get. And, you know, that's why America exported prohibition so well, because they came here with all the fear mongering, go, oh, well, they're doing it.
And LaGuardia was always like, you know, because there was a lot of jazz music in New York. And so there's a lot of reefermen walking around and having a wonderful swinging time. But LaGuardia, Mayor LaGuardia in the 40s, he studied, that was some of the first studies. Like, oh, let's make it illegal and then we'll do the studies. And he's like, okay, let's study it. And he's, so since like the LaGuardia report and whatever frickin' year that was, hey, can we get a bumper from those moments in weed history while I try to find the LaGuardia report? All right, I got it right here, and I'm going to be passing the data on over to Lauren and maybe even to the folks at home. Here is the synopsis of the 1944 findings of the LaGuardia report. And so in 1944, the New York Academy of Medicine issued an extensively researched report declaring that, contrary to earlier research and popular belief, use of marijuana did not induce violence, insanity, or sex crime, or lead to addiction or other drug use. Marijuana is used extensively in the borough of Manhattan, but the problem is not as acute as it is reported to be in other sections of the United States.
That's so funny that there's that. And then I have a book that I've been reading. It's a little tiny pamphlet, but from 1950, it had to do with a psychological report of the cannabis consumer. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this psychologist was just, and he helped, was on part of the normal, created normal, but his findings were the cannabis consumer learns about cannabis from another consumer, and that's how it's how a community develops, right? It's not like heroin where you're like, oh, I'm hooked. Like, this is something I need right away. It's like you have to learn how to be high. You have to learn what the experience is.
Well, you can feel the pangs of addiction. I mean, like anybody who's gotten a few cigarettes in them might then be like, hey, why do I want another one of those? They were terrible. And there you go. Now you've seen what an addiction is. With weed, I'm like, man, that was great. And then 3 days will go by, I'll be like, oh, I could go for that again. Yeah. That's not addiction. That's more along the lines of cheesecake. It's like, oh, I love that. Well, I haven't had that in a while. Oh, my God. Let's have some of that.
Yeah. No, I like that analogy. Like
cheesecake, you know, you're getting coronaries and fat. And, you know, like if cheesecake was good for you.
Cannabis is like a fluffy blanket that you just want to have on you in a cold winter day or a nice fresh water on a hot day.
It helps. It does. And it's been helping me. It's been paying for the bills for a bit until all this, you know, if this doesn't work out, I guess I could always sell insurance.
If this doesn't work out, I'm fucked. Hey, we got one last story you want to go over.
Oh, international news. Let's hit it.